tonight night at the LaSalle iconic stadium. We hoped it might be epic, and in the end it really was. Absolutely magnificent effort by the Dutch to get back into the game from 2-0 down, get it back to 2-1 and then 2-2. Off into extra time, where Argentina came close to stealing a late winner. They didn't quite manage it, and so we went to penalties and the drama ensued. And in the end, it was an Argentine player with the letter M who came up trumps. On this occasion, not necessarily Lionel Messi, but in fact Emiliano Martinez, who saved the first two Dutch penalties. And there's the road to the final, or the path to the final, whatever you prefer, really taking shape now. The first semi-final has been decided. Croatia and Argentina will meet in the first semi-final. The second will be decided tomorrow. Well, the Argentine fans have made the journey in huge numbers, probably the biggest representation for any single country at this Qatar World Cup 2022. And they've been rewarded now with a place in the semi-final. Well, that ebbed and flowed and ebbed and flowed and dragged us through all sorts of emotions, Karen. When these two countries have met in the past, this is the sort of game that has been produced, and we don't know why it happens, but it happened again. 16 yellow cards, 10 penalties, and I'm sure there are lots of other statistics that will be rolled out over the next few days, but it was an epic encounter.
Yeah, it really was. Went down to the wire. Like you said, it ebbed and flowed. You thought the emotions were going to overspill at times from the Argentines, and I think that it's an overwhelming relief at the end. You'd have thought that they could have managed the game at 2-0. Fair play to the Dutch for coming back into it. They showed serious character and bravery to try the free kick at the end. Were resilient in extra time, but missing those first two penalties just put them under pressure. And I mean, it was still dramatic up to the final kick. And Martinez, what a story he's been for Argentina since he's come in. He was the understudy for so long at Arsenal, and then goes, gets his debut, wins a Copa America, and now he's the hero again, bringing them into the semi-final.
Kenny, for a while it looked as if it was all slipping away, the dream from Lionel Messi to make another World Cup final, but maybe on this occasion be on the winning side. That dream is still alive for him.
Oh, certainly. It's nice to see those pictures there, actually, Peter. For most of his international career, Lionel Messi kind of wears that mask, doesn't he? It's very hard to tell how emotionally involved he is with the international team. I think that was a criticism of him. Initially, he went to Spain at a young age. When he came into the senior international fold, some people kind of questioned his kind of commitment to the international team, to the jersey, in fact. But certainly in this competition, the last couple of games, the scenes we've seen post-match, you know, can't leave anybody under any illusion in terms of how much it means to him celebrating here with his teammates. He was instrumental again this evening for his team, Pete, and he's going to have to be. He's going to have to drag this Argentinian team into the final. I wouldn't say single-handedly, but he's clearly a huge, huge asset to the team, and he's the one they all look to for inspiration, and he provided that inspiration again tonight.
And this possibly spells the end of Louis van Gaal's career as an international boss. He hasn't completely ruled out of taking on another role, but you have to give him enormous credit for what he did in that second half. First of all, he made two substitute changes at halftime, which is a brave move by any manager, because you can't have a disgruntled dressing room very quickly. But then the substitutions he made later on in the second half, they brought the Dutch back into the game.
Yeah, I mean, it was still on a knife edge at halftime. They were only the one goal down, but Weghorst and Berghaus really made such a difference when they came on. They were, you could just target them. We saw they were getting at the Argentines. They were getting ratty, giving away free kicks. And they looked dangerous from any set play, and you thought that maybe they could still nick one. They defended quite well, didn't give Argentina too many chances until the second half of extra time. And Van Gaal definitely deserves a lot of credit, because, like I said, emotions were overspilling. It was the Argentines who were losing their heads, getting in and around the referee. Van Gaal was calming his players down, and it's hard to look at the scenes there, because they really did pour their heart into this game.
It's amazing, because you'd actually be critical of Scaloni. You're speaking about Van Gaal in terms of the substitutions, sporting substitutions, the impact they had on the game, but Scaloni had some big decisions to make. He bought Paredes on a relatively experienced centre midfielder, second half, cruising at 2-0, and he had the opposite effect. He started picking fights with everybody around the pitch. Paredes seemed intent on raising the temperature of the game. Peter, when really they wanted the opposite, the Argentinian team. And then 78 minutes in, another two big decisions. Took Acuna and Romero off for both Callian carrying yellow cards. Again, tuned up thinking he was safe. And that wasn't the case. Pazzala, who came on at centre-half, speaking to Karen about it, really struggled. Couldn't get up to the tempo. The game was making mistake after mistake. Bundled over the Dutch player in the lead-up to the second goal. So it's amazing, really, in terms of those big decisions, key moments of the game. Van Gaal was getting everything right, and Scaloni, it seemed, was getting everything wrong in terms of substitutions.
And Van Gaal was receiving an awful lot of criticism from the Dutch media, but I think his methods for this particular World Cup have proven to be correct. I don't think they could have approached it in any other way, bar the way he went around it today.
No, he went for a more attacking approach with Berghaus coming on, and Weghorst, he went for it. He changed to the four at the back when he felt that that was right and it was effective. He's shown that he is a bit more dynamic and willing to change his ways in this tournament. And I think the Dutch did themselves really proud today. I mean, it was a drab enough first half, but when things needed to be changed, he recognised that at halftime, making the double substitution. It did change the course of the game.
It certainly did, and we've an awful lot to reflect on what was a very dramatic night in Lusail. Absolutely dramatic evening. We've an awful lot to get through, so we better get straight into it. And first of all, 73rd minute, Argentina awarded a penalty. Up steps Lionel Messi, and you think, well, if he scores this, it's probably game over and they'll manage it from 2-0 out. First of all, was the decision clear-cut as far as you were concerned, Karen?
I mean, yeah, it was. Acuna hadn't had much joy down that side in the first half, rarely getting past Dumfries, who had him for pace and power. This time, Dumfries just gets too close to him and he can't move his left leg out of the way in time. And I don't think we ever really doubted that Lionel Messi was going to put it past No Part there. And you really thought that they were home and dry. The celebrations kind of said that as well, and after that Argentina just seemed to lose their way a little bit. But that celebration, and he did the same celebration after his penalty after the game, those pictures are going to become iconic, because again Messi stepped up and he produced when they needed him most.
Yeah, absolutely magnificent penalty, and I think we thought probably that's going to be it, Kenny, but then Luis inspired substitutions and Weghorst got them back in the game.
Yeah, he certainly did. Yeah, two big lumps up the pitch. Old school this. Get the ball into a wide area. Don't overcomplicate the game, Peter. Just put it into a good area. That's exactly what Berghaus does off his left foot. It's a brilliant in-swinging ball. He's on the move, Weghorst. Classic centre-forward run across the defender. It was Martinez. Can't do anything about it. Lovely touch. Good pace on the ball. Just has to get the direction right. Now Ray was a little bit critical of Martinez. I wouldn't be overly critical. Myself just kind of bounced in front of him. Yeah, great link-up play. And that gave him hope. Gave them a lifeline.
It gave them hope. And then when we saw 10 minutes of added time, said, well, more could happen here. But then we got to that 10th minute and they were awarded a free kick. And you can imagine the mental fatigue at that stage, never mind the physical fatigue. So whoever decided to take this particular set piece, it was a genius decision, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was absolutely incredible. Rush of blood to the head here by Argentina. Absolutely no need to give away that free kick when you have that many men behind the ball. Just stand them up, force him out wide, because they were dealing with crosses all day. But you see these players at the edge of the wall, they just distract and you don't know which one it's going to. In the end, it goes to Weghorst. But to have the, I suppose, the cojones to do a free kick like that at that stage of the game, how many of those free kicks do we see blasted straight into the wall?
Yeah.
But to try something like that in the 90 plus 11 minutes, it's outrageous. And even the finish was very cool. He could have gone to the near side of the keeper, who, and I think he might have had it covered, but he was kind of blindsided by his own defender there. And yeah, I just thought maybe it was going to be the Dutch day after that, but Argentina came back and really rose to the challenge in extra time again.
I think there had to be a bit of eye contact there, Karen, because Weghorst is not surprised when the ball arrives at his feet.
Yeah.
Had to be a little bit. It wouldn't have been word spoken. You've probably
Be sure that he'd be the one you'd pick out though in that.
No, not
scenario,
necessarily. But
so
I think he recognised that Berghaus. Yeah. There was a little overload there. A little 3v1 would have just made contact with Weghorst, and that would have been enough.
But definitely something they worked on the training ground, Kenny.
Definitely not. 100% definitely wouldn't have worked. I don't think so. That's instinctive. That's in the moment, I think. That's what I'm talking about. Just eye contact, straight away, players knowing, are you on? I'm going to pop this into you without a word being spoken. It's a brilliant play.
Funny enough, I find that very hard to swallow. that they didn't work on that.
We're not going to prove it here this evening, won't we?
We're not. We'll have to get in contact with Louis after the programme. OK, let's talk about the referee's influence on the game and the way he lost control. And we noticed a little moment between himself and Messi, and it all stemmed from there after that.
Yeah, we highlighted this at half-time. It's not overly unusual you see this. Obviously, he's at, you know, asked him for his maybe his Messi's jerseys. Yeah, he can be boots as well, anything you want, really, if you look after us. And he certainly looked after Messi here. I mean, that's literally, that's 100%. It has to be a yellow card then. So I think that's where the Dutch start getting a bit frustrated. This was never a foul as well. Berghuis then gets yellow carded probably for protesting. So this was building. This is Paredes here. Now, this is what I'm talking about. He was pouring, like, petrol onto the fire, Paredes. He got yellow carded for that. Peter, he could have got another yellow card for smashing the ball at the Dutch dugout, but I think it actually energised the Dutch team. This is what I'm talking about. I think they gained an advantage from it and kept kind of pushing. I think it really helped them and not the Argentinian team. We had a fracas after the game. There was yellow cards being given out kind of left, right and centre. It was absolute mayhem. And usually the Argentinians, they usually love this environment.
Yeah.
It's kind of orchestrated mayhem for them. They usually thrive in it, Peter. But this evening, I think, one of those few occasions, I think it actually went against them.
Yeah, well, we're trying to figure out, our statisticians are working feverishly behind the scenes, trying to figure out whether it was 16 or 17 yellow cards in that game, because there were so many dished out, everybody lost count. But we do believe it's a World Cup record, but it's just part of what was an intriguing story this evening in Lusail. Those celebrations, you can imagine, will go long into the evening, but of course they have a big semi-final to look forward to against Croatia, and we look forward to that very shortly. But first of all, Kenny, I suppose in many ways justice was done, because in extra time, Argentina came so close on seven or eight occasions to getting the goal that would have won it in extra time.
Yeah, it really shocked me, Peter. They must have been like dizzy in terms of how the game had got away from them, but they actually pulled themselves together and came on really strong, created chance after chance in the second period of extra time. Was absolutely relentless. And I think it was actually a factor, Peter, in terms of the penalty shootout. I think they went into the penalty shootout in a better kind of mindset off the back of these chances which they created. Fernandes as well, for me, is an interesting one. Scaloni played him in a deep midfield position today, Peter. I didn't think it suited him. And he took the breaks off him at this period of extra time, sent him higher up the pitch. Yeah. And he was a big factor, you know, creating chances for people. This is Di Maria late on, almost catching the goalkeeper out. Just committing players into the box, pushing. This is Fernandes again. This is what I'm talking about. This kid can shoot. We saw against Mexico that beautiful goal that he got. So I think it was a mistake. I think he made a few errors there this evening, Scaloni, in terms of personnel.
So do you think it could possibly prompt a change for the manager in the semi-final?
Yeah, I'll be very interested. I don't think we'll see Fernandes play as deep as he did in the first half of the game. I'll tell you that, because when he gets to the opposition half and around the penalty box, he's a real threat. He can score and create goals. He's got a couple of issues high up the pitch in terms of personnel. Martinez looked lively when he came on. He scored a winning penalty. That'll help him, because he's been a disappointment in the tournament. Messi needs help. I still don't think Messi can win this tournament by himself, Peter. He needs that supporting cast to step up and chip in, and more of them need to do it.
Yeah, that's a very good point, and it brings us nicely to the Lionel Messi package, because at the end of the day, the decisive moments involved Lionel Messi, as they have done right throughout this tournament.
Well, yeah, he's going to give it a good go of winning it by himself if he needs to. We were talking about how much he walked during the game, and in the first half we saw him actually closing down a good bit. And he kind of set the tone. He was the first one to kind of get a shot off. And this is unbelievable again, just the way he can pick it up and the vision that he showed for the goal and set them on their way. But he was producing these moments all throughout the game when they really, really needed him. There were times in the first half in particular where Argentina looked a bit devoid of just knowing what to do. And when they do that, they just look for Messi. And you can see why. Here he is coming deep, two players around him, no mean feat to get away from De Jong like that and just get them out of pressure. And you thought that this one was going to nestle into the top corner, and it would have been a fitting third goal for him as well, because he is just that good. And I think I speak on behalf of a lot of people. I'm glad that that wasn't his last game in an Argentina jersey.
He looks sharp, Peter, physically, moving over the ground. Just his movement, quite dynamic, almost played every minute of every game, and he's looking strong, and that'll be a big plus going forward.
OK, well, let's just remind you about the path to the final once again, just before we have our final chat this evening. And there you can see that Argentina through to the semi-final, where they'll meet Croatia. It's not the semi-final most were expecting. They thought it would be an all South American affair, but Brazil bowed out on penalties to the Croatians today. And it just sets up an intriguing encounter in so many ways. And people talk, about players ageing and tiring and stuff like that. And we have Luka Modric, who looked, again, sprightly enough for Croatia today. Lionel Messi possibly had his best game for Argentina tonight. So it sets up an extraordinary encounter, not the one we imagined, but Croatia have shown that they're such a resilient team and could easily take Argentina all the way.
Yeah, I think it's really intriguing because I think that Argentina have had to show a lot of grit, but on the flip side, Croatia have probably had to show even more coming two consecutive extra times in penalty shootouts, and Modric staying on the pitch for that whole time and stepping up and taking a penalty. It's like he's evergreen. I think Frankie de Jong is the closest person to him at the moment, as someone who can just completely manage a game and control a midfield. And it was a bit hectic in midfield for Argentina today, so it'll be interesting to see how they nullify that. But again, it could be another spicy affair like Croatia. They're no wilting flowers, so there'll be plenty more challenges, and I think there'll be a few suspensions for the final, whatever way it goes.
Kenny, what do you think of that semi-final lineup?
Yeah, I'd give Argentina the edge ever so slightly. I'd agree with Karen. There's a lot of similarities between the teams in terms of kind of defensive structure, very solid defensively, kind of battle-hardened teams, very wily individual operators sprinkled around the pitch. So I'm really, really looking forward to it. Modric is the obvious standout player, of course, for Croatia. And they've been here before, seen it and done it, the Croatian team. So, you know, won't be overwhelmed at the thought of facing Lionel Messi in the semi-final. Tight game to call, but I'd lean towards Argentina. I think just psychologically they're in a really good place at the moment, and Messi in particular has really surprised me physically, how he's coping with the demands of the tournament and the pressure mentally that's on his shoulders as well.
Yeah, well, one way or another, it's another huge World Cup match to look forward to. It's been quite a day of football. Brazil have bowed out, Croatia march on, but so too do Argentina.